Ladies and gentlemen, if you'd like to take your seats. Yes, oh yes. Do you know, ladies and gentlemen, journalists love nothing more than to be taken seriously. So when I said to you this was a conversation, I realized that what this would mean is that people would not stop talking and would make it very difficult sometimes to start on time. But that's okay. There aren't that many rules in the day. And I have to say, as a Canadian, which a country of immigrants, where I'm always asking people where they came from, just to wander through the midst and to look at people's name tags, you feel like you're walking through the ancestry of centuries past and the names which come from far and wide. There's such a rich heritage in this room, just all of you who have gathered here today. And our program now is going to take another turn. In fact, our next guest seems to have, well, been inspired by the hand of God. You couldn't make it up. A man whose name is Khalid Al Baih from Khartoum, who draws cartoons, and not just cartoons. Khalid Al Baih's pen was drawing lines in the political sands of the so-called Arab Spring. He made it onto the hallowed walls in Cairo and Beirut, and he's made it right across the Arab world and Egypt. Read his Twitter account, and he describes himself as self-proclaimed artist, political cartoonist, illustrator, designer, a dyslexic, of course spelled in a certain way, writer from the two Sudans. Please join me in welcoming Khalid Al Baih, who will also be joined by another special guest. Everything today is exactly the same, but completely different, because he will be accompanied by an oud player, a Palestinian, Zayd Tayem, who's Palestinian and Dutch. Alan Wasala.
Thank you very much. Assalamu alaikum, everybody. Good morning. Like many my age in the region, like Bouazizi and others, I was frustrated by the rejection of people in power. I tried to publish my cartoons again and again in newspapers around the region, but I was faced with bureaucracy, censorship. So I did what other artists and activists did. I went to the internet. It was either that or die trying to get to Europe. I would like to thank the Rabbani Foundation for giving me the chance to tell the story of our ongoing story of our generation, the generation of the Arab Spring. So, here's the story. We were perfect. Hopeless. But it all started with hands reaching out. Reaching out through the grapevine. The first God fell. And we hope the rest will follow. It was as clear as math. The unwanted child was born. they had held on. They fed off of each other. But we had to keep going. Like the spring, we had to keep coming. We were one since a very long time. We had hope again. And again. But they came back. They called it reforms. Democracy. We parted ways again. Things got out of hand. We were confused. We forgot why we started. So we did it again. But again they came. And again. They came back mad. They hunted us down. But we still have our weapons. And inshallah, we are almost there. Thank you.
Shukran. And now you know why some of the people in power did not want him to publish. Thank you very, very much. No better illustration of how sometimes it's not just a picture's worth 1,000 words, that a cartoon is worth even more. Thank you very, very much, Khalid Al Baih. And I think you're also happy to answer a few questions. This is a rare opportunity for you to ask such a leading cartoonist. You can even ask a question of the oud player if you like. Everyone is in the conversation. Shukran ekthiya, shukran. Anyone like? Any other aspiring cartoonists out there? Everyone is simply speechless.
My name is Adil Awaji. I'm just curious, what was the momentum where you actually started drawing these cartoons? What was the trigger?
Each of these cartoons, I did this the same day of an event that happened. The one with Tunis as an octopus, that was the same day that the revolution started to happen, and it was all over Al Jazeera, and people were talking about it. So, and there was so much hope And as I said, you know, I exist online. I only work online. And this is where I met a lot of other artists. And there was so much hope that this will spread. And we all knew that it will all spread because, we all knew we were all the same. It doesn't matter where you are in Sudan, in Tunis, and in Egypt. We all want positive change. So each one of it comes with its own story.
And your last cartoon seemed to suggest that you haven't completely lost hope. It was entitled Almost There. What keeps you hopeful?
We have nothing else.
What kind of reaction have you been getting to your... Does the reaction to your cartoons, not just in your native Sudan, across the Arab world, and in Europe, also give you hope that there is a common language that, that people are speaking?
I mean, because working online, you get to experience the opinion of people straight away. So I work on Facebook, I work on Twitter, I work on Instagram, and people comment. And of course, sometimes, you know, they disagree. A lot of times they disagree. But it's a place where everybody meets, you know. It's a place where these people will not talk to each other anywhere else. Like an Islamist and a liberal will not have this dialogue. And they do. And a lot of times, you know, when you go down the comments, okay, you know, they swear at each other. They're very angry. They swear at me. And then at the end, they become friends. And you can see when I post something else later on that they're actually talking. They got over the fact that they're different. That they're talking. And this is, I think, this is what we need most. I mean, it's just that dialogue, and this is why we're here as well.
And could you also let us know, because when you leave us today, I think a lot of us will want to follow your work. We also want to know whether we have to worry about you. Do you sometimes get threats as well? You're okay with your very incisive approach to cartoonism?
When I do get threats, this is when I know that a cartoon is actually effective, that it's hurting a point. And most of my cartoons are not. They're not funny. They're because the situation is not funny, and I try to shake something out of you, and so yeah. When you get threats, that means you actually shook the right person. So,
Do you know, today you're speaking to an audience. Today we have with us, we have musicians, we have filmmakers, we have diplomats, we have envoys, we have people who communicate with many different methods. Before you leave the stage, tell us why you think cartoon is so powerful. You could have done many things. You could have been a videographer. Mm. You could have been a photographer. You could have done landscape painting, oils. But for you, why? What attracted you to cartoons?
Growing up in the region, and at that time
in
Sudan and in Doha, in Qatar. As you know, my parents are expats, and they left Sudan because of the political situation, and most of the expats, the Arab expats, were they told us that our parents told us to stay out of politics, and because this is the reason why we're not in our countries, it's politics. So for me, I was just trying to understand the political situation, and I noticed that no matter if you're interested in politics or not, people always. You know, people don't even read the news in the front page anymore. They turn to the last page and see the cartoon. So this is most approachable to everybody. You don't need to be a curator. You don't need to study art. You don't need to be a professor. Anybody can understand it, and it's very close, and it affects the situation. And as I said, you know, if it wasn't so dangerous, people wouldn't have got killed, like Najil Ali or Ali or Najib Farzat, Ali Farzat in Syria, who got assaulted because of a cartoon as well. So this is the kind of reaction that I want to get, and this is I want to make a real difference, even if it's with something as simple as a few sketches.
You've already made a difference in our day. Khalid Al Baih, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, I have to say in advance that the next